The tessellation stages in OpenGL provide three different subdivision methods: isolines, quads, and triangles. In a previous video on tessellation, we've used isolines to render a Bezier curve, so in this one we will move on to quads. Now, quads are more complex compared to isolines, so as a first step I'd like to demonstrate the capability of this subdivision algorithm. This will make it easier down the road to visualize how things will be rendered. Before we get started, I'd like to say a big thank you to Shavket Tekin, who recently joined the OpenGL Underground. If you too would like to support this channel, you can do that at patreon.com/OGLdev or by joining the YouTube channel as a member. Remember that the job of the tessellator is to subdivide one of the three basic shapes and output a series of 2D or 3D points in the range of 0 to 1. In the case of quads, we get 2D points, and we have 6 tessellation levels that allow us to control the tessellation process: 4 outer levels and 2 inner levels. Setting all the tessellation levels to 1 effectively disables tessellation entirely. In this case, we get 2 triangles, which is the minimum for this type of shape. If any of the levels is 0, we get nothing. Now let's see what the inner tessellation levels do. These levels create a ring of squares around the center of the quad. We have 2 of them. One controls the top and bottom edges, and the other the left and the right. If we set both inner levels to 3, we can easily see a single ring around the center square. The reason that we get this is that the 2 inner levels are actually applied on their respective outer edges, top-bottom and left-right. This happens regardless the value of the outer levels. So when both of them are set to 3, the outer edges are divided to 3 segments each, and if you apply a bit of imagination, you can see 3x3 squares. The squares of the outer ring are of course hidden, because by definition, the inner levels affect the inner part of the quad. If at this point we decrease one of the inner levels to 2, or even 1, then the inner square is degenerated into a line, but we can still imagine a ring around the center here. We can continue increasing the inner levels, and each increment adds another segment on the respective 2 edges, and as you can see, this makes the inner part of the quad grow in size and decreases the size of the outermost ring. This ring is controlled by the outer tessellation levels, and we have more control here because each edge has its own level. As you can see, the outer tessellation levels simply subdivide their respective edges into segments and tessellate this portion of the outer ring with triangles. But it gets more interesting than that, and the reason is that the tessellation levels are actually floating points and not integers, which is what we've been using in this demo so far. So we can change the entire pipeline from the GUI down to the shader level to floats, and we are still getting the same result. This is because equal spacing is specified in the evaluation shader. This makes all the subdivided segments equal in length, so a new one pops out whenever we cross an integer level. But we can also use fractional odd spacing to provide a smoother effect. In this case, when the tessellation level becomes greater than 1, we can see 2 new segments growing from the 2 sides. Whenever the tessellation level crosses an odd number, the process repeats itself with 2 new segments. Since we have fractional odd spacing, then it stands to reason that there is also fractional even spacing. The difference is that the new segments appear as soon as we cross an even threshold. So we always have a point in the center of the edge, and the process repeats itself symmetrically on both sides. If you're interested in learning how to create such a demo, then simply keep on watching. I will assume that you are familiar with the basics of tessellation, so if you need a refresher, you are welcome to watch my previous video on this topic. See the link in the video description. Okay, so we need to create 4 vertices to represent the quad, and for that I have 4 corners going from -1 by -1 to 1 by 1. I think that what often confuses people is that they believe that the primitives from the vertex buffer are being tessellated, when in fact the tessellator generates normalized points for the specific shapes that we see here. Then we take these points and interpolate between the actual vertices of the input patch. That's one option at least. So we can modify the position of these vertices and deform the quad, but the tessellator still generates the same output, regardless of the position of the incoming vertices. Now I'm going to take these vertices and initialize a utility class called VertexBuffer, which will create a VAO, VertexBuffer and VertexLayout, to pipe these vertices to the vertex shader. This is not special in any way, and you can review the code later on. What is important here is to use the glpatches as the topology type for the draw call and set glpatchVertices using glpatchParameterI to the number of vertices, which is 4 in this case. Then glDrawArrays is called with glpatches 0 and 4 as parameters. Now the pipeline starts running and we get to the vertex shader, which is very simple. We take the 2D position, add 0 for Z and 1 for W, and send it on its way. The next stop is the tessellation control shader, or the TCS. This shader stage defines the number of output vertices to 4. We are not changing the input patch here, and each input vertex is copied from the GLIN array to the GLOUT array based on the current GLINvocation ID, which is a running index between 0 and 3. The TCS is responsible for updating the tessellation levels, so we have 6 uniforms for that. The outer level has 4 values for the 4 sides of the quad, and the inner level has 2, top-bottom and left-right. They need to be copied into the internal variables GLTessLevelOuter and inner. This allows the application to dynamically change the level of tessellation. What happens next is that the tessellator is activated and generates all the intermediate points along the quad based on the tessellation level, while the patch skips the tessellator and goes from the TCS to the TES. So we are now in the tessellation evaluation shader. First of all, we use the layout specifier to define a few things. The tessellator algorithm is set to quads, the spacing between the points is set to equal. We can also set this to fractional odd or even, as we have seen. The output winding order is set to counterclockwise. This needs to match the front-facing order in your application. If you don't see anything, make sure these guys are in sync. Next, we extract the current point from the tessellator output. This value resides in the internal variable glTessChord, and it can go between 0 and 1. Remember that the TES is invoked once, or at least once, for every tessellated point. What we need to do now is to use the point that came from the tessellator to interpolate between the 4 corners of the quad. This is a standard bilinear interpolation. U represents the x-axis, so the 2 points on the left are multiplied by U, and the 2 points on the right are multiplied by 1 minus U. V represents the y-axis, so the 2 bottom points are multiplied by V, and the 2 top points are multiplied by 1 minus V. Combining everything together results in the final point. We also multiply the result by the WVP matrix. This allows us to move the camera around as usual. If we drop this, we simply get the quad stretched across the entire window without the ability to change the point of view. Finally, the fragment shader is also very simple. We just need to output a color, which can be configured by the application. Okay, so I hope you've got a good idea what quad tessellation can do. In an actual game, we can use it to do level of detail for terrain rendering. I plan to do a video about it in the near future, so make sure to subscribe, and I will see you in the next one.